times are changing. Reimbursement is changing from quantity to quality. I think this comes as no surprise. I must start off with a conflict of interest. Unit modeler software is what we're going to be talking about. That's what Test and Teach is using. It's a product of Key Labs, and Key Labs is owned by my son, Tom, and I got him into this business. Here's a recent statement from the American Society of Echocardiography in the daily kind of newsletter that they give out. And it says that as of July 25th, 2016, just a few months ago, the CMS proposed three new significant policies, including mandatory bundled, that is, I think most of you know, is a new way of paying for a variety of tests and whatever for acute myocardial infarction and also bypass surgery. And let me just turn right to the implications for ASC members. And this is from Irene Butler, who is the lobbyist for the American Society of Echocardiography and knows pretty much what's going on in Washington with regard to these issues. ASC members practicing at participating hospitals are likely to be under considerable pressure to improve quality and reduce costs for patients admitted for heart attacks and bypass procedures. I think that is the probability of the future. Now, here are some basic truisms that I've used from the very beginning. The most expensive test that you can order is one that gives false information. The second most expensive test is one that gives inadequate information. I have frequently said that ordering a test is like throwing a pass in a football game. Three things can happen. You obviously want to complete the pass to get towards the goal. When you order a test, you want to get new information. You have to take care of the patient. However, there are two other things that can happen. The pass can be dropped. You wasted a down. You can get inadequate information. You've wasted money, time, and resources. But there is yet a third option. The third option is the pass can be intercepted and you're worse than you began. You can get a test that gives you false information and it's a disaster. The effects of change on echocardiography. Other imaging modalities are now no longer going to be complementary. That's what we always use to order a number of tests on the same person. Other imaging modalities will now become competitive because complementary is too expensive. You can't do all these cardiac imaging tests on a given patient, not when you're bundling, not when you're reimbursed for quality, not just quantity. Echocardiography cannot be a preliminary examination requiring more tests. See, I've always was nervous that somebody with, say, cardiac MR will come out and say, look, we know we're more expensive. We know we're not as convenient. However, we are the ultimate gold standard. We've got the final answer. Don't bother wasting your time with preliminary echo because they do not give a definitive answer. You want to get the definitive answer? Go right to where you're going to get it first time. Echo must be definitive and with improved quality. So how do we improve echocardiography quality and make it more definitive? Now, I could talk about some improvement in technology. I can talk about a strain of other issues that go into this. But I just want to talk about one particular item, and that is the accuracy and variability of measurements and interpretations must be checked, recognized, and improved. Echocardiography has many competitive advantages over other modalities. There's no radiation, no magnetic issues, can be obtained almost anywhere. Wealth of anatomic and physiologic information. Images created in real time, it's not composite. Real image creation, not influenced by heart rate or heart rhythm, things that are very critical for CT as well as MR. The interpretation is a matter of minutes, and results are immediately available. and it's universally available and less costly. We should be a winner, but we have some disadvantages. Real-world images are frequently of lesser quality, but they are getting better. Echocardiographic measurements and interpretation are not easy, especially with lesser quality images. Partially because echocardiography has no inherent danger, like radiation, and is less costly, examination is being performed and interpreted by people with variable skill and training. That's just a fact of life. It's been there all the time, since the very inception. Because it's so relatively inexpensive and it doesn't seem to be hurting anybody physically, a lot of people who are of lesser quality and training get into the act. Any resulting differences in accuracy and variability need to be identified, monitored, and corrected. Practice of medicine is becoming more consolidated. Hospitals are buying up practices and other hospitals. Echocardiography laboratories are growing. Echocardiographic examinations are being performed and interpreted by sonographers and readers with variable backgrounds and training. Partially because of the increasing size and heterogeneity of the personnel, variability and inaccuracy in reporting is increasing. Here's a study that came out just a year ago in JACE. Now, it wasn't exactly related to variability of different individuals measuring things, but it was the variability and actually the error in measuring common echocardiographic measurements. And in this case, it was in comparing to strain. But look at the bar graph. The posterior wall thickness, which, of course, is one of the most important measurements that we do. It depends whether there's hypertrophy, there's not hypertrophy. There is a 17% error. Now, this is an intervendor error, but I can tell you that would work with interpersonal error as well. And even the Doppler E to A ratio has almost a 20% error. This is real world, not what we write about. It's not what you read in the literature. This is real world data. So the principles behind test and teach, which is the subject of this webinar. Although the title says test and teach, a primary goal is discovery. How is real-world echocardiography being practiced and how can it be improved? Thus, the images being evaluated must be of real-world quality, not idealized diagrams or of exceptionally good quality. Test and teach utilizes simulation software for both education and evaluation. What do you mean by simulation? That is learning that is based on a concept that you will remember that which you got right, wrong, correction, which you got wrong longer than that which you got right, and you will learn from your mistakes. You think about it, we all can remember our errors far longer than that which we got right. The user gets feedback as soon as the case is completed for his educational value. All of the user results are monitored for individual and group evaluation. It's all permanently recorded. The user's results are compared with the creator's results for accuracy and with the results of peers for variability. And then a meeting discussing the results is highly recommended and meets an IAC accreditation requirement. Now, let's talk about how we use test and teach for measurements. One of the major features of test and teach is there is a permanent storage and display of all the measurements. So you don't know you don't get just a value of what a measurement was, but you can see where the measurement was actually done. And that is critical and very major feature of this whole process. Here's a typical example. It's not a pretty image. It's not something you're going to see in almost any meeting that you go to. No one's going to dare show an image that looks like this. But this is what you see every day. And this is what you have to live with. And this is what you have to interpret. And this is what you have to measure. That's the whole goal. Real world, not what you want it to be, what it is. And here's an example of what you might do. So here's the image. And the instructions at the top there will say make a measurement. And showed the after you've made the measurements, you can then submit them. In other words, if you hit try, that will give me an ability to make a measurement. And if I want to see what I did, I can hit show, and it'll show me exactly what I did. It'll show the actual measurement itself. And the same goes for all the other measurements that are listed here. And once you're convinced that they're all right, you live right, then you hit submit, and now they are permanently stored. You can't go back and change them. And when they're stored, that means you're going to be able to see them. And anybody else who has privileges to monitor this will also see them. And when you're done, you will get a readout of where your measurement was. That's the user result up here, and what the creator thought that measurement should be. And, for example, if this is the interventricular septum, the user got 1.02 centimeters, and the creator said 1.07 centimeters. And if you want to see where these were done, if you'd click here on view, then you see something like this. And in green is where the creator made the measurement, and in yellow, you see where you made the measurement. And then you can see where all of the people, all of the sonographers in this particular case made measurements. And in this case, there was 13 sonographers who made all these measurements. One of them, for some reason or other, didn't make these last four measurements. And here you can see the mean value of the user users, the sonographers, and here's the creator. And this gives you a classification to this degree. In other words, these are normal measurements. Well, two of them must have been a 1.2 or above, because that's out of the limits. And so this would mean that the interpretation might be altered by those two measurements. All the other 11 would be still created as normal. And then you could see where all of those 13 measurements were made on this. Now, I know some of you already are saying, wait a minute, that's not where I make my measurements. Wait a minute. Those are not the ASC guidelines approved. All that. We'll get into where in just a bit. But anyway, this shows you exactly how they can all be displayed and looking at it. And here, for example, the same story for the wall thickness. You can measure that. And then again, although they were very close, there were five that were out of the agreement of what should be normal. And then you look at the, and you say, wait a minute, this is where seeing where the measurements are made are so critical. Three of these people actually measured the pericardial effusion. There's a small pericardial effusion here, and they thought that that was the myocardium. Hopefully those three did learn, because they immediately found out that that's not where I thought it was, and it turned out none of their peers did either. So there's the learning part of test and teach. And you can see the real world where people actually make measurement. And it's difficult. This posterior wall in particular is a tough posterior wall. You have to see exactly where that endocardium is and the such. There's room for question. That's the nature of what we're dealing with, and that's what we're trying to assess in doing this. Here we do the same thing with wall motion, with the cavity size. Here you see the cavity, and it should be here. This is where I feel that it is proper, and this one does agree with the ASC guideline that you all recognize, at least I hope you do. Anyway, but you can see where the rest of it is. Some of them couldn't identify the endocardium, and the endocardium is a faint echo and can be very difficult to identify at times, and that's part of the problem. But this is the real world. This is what happens. You got to know that. You can't correct something until at least you know that there is a problem. Hopefully, if there's no problems, wow, that's really great. But I'm concerned that there are. So, do we help? Is this exercise useful? Do they learn from their mistakes? Well, I did we've been doing this for over 2 years now. And here was, I did a technically poor image, which is very common. And they had trouble. Like there's a 20%, 24% variability on measuring the septum and the posterior wall. It was tough, and I'm not surprised. But I had them do it a year later. They didn't know it was the same study, but it wasn't exactly the same study. And they improved. They not great, but it's also very difficult. But look what they did with the Simpsons. Here was a Simpsons measurement. This is the area that they had. The variability went from 15% to almost 7.5%. And this one went from 14 to almost 5.5%. So there is a dramatic improvement. And these types of improvement have been persistent, and we've tested this occasionally since then. So, yes, they do learn from the mistakes, and that's a very encouraging sign. At least they know that things have to be changed. Now, one of the things that we have to measure is ejection fraction. And I'm using this just as an example. Obviously, we make all kinds of measurements, but ejection fraction is an important one. Some people think that's the only reason they order an echocardiogram. It's just to get the ejection fraction. I can argue with that, but that's another story. Well, here's what we would look at for ejection. And again, wow, who would ever want to show that kind of an image at a meeting? But that's a real-world image, and I'm sure all of you have seen images like that all the time. And that's the four-chamber view, and here's the two-chamber view. Not pretty by a long shot. Okay, what's the variability in measuring? Try to measure the areas of those structures to calculate a biplane Simpson's rule ejection fraction, which is the guidelines preferred way of measuring ejection fraction. Well, just looking at the four-chamber view alone, just for the area, there was about a 14% variability rate of just measuring the four-chamber view all by itself, and about a 13% variability in systole, just diastole systole. Not great, but not good either. Well, how about the physicians? Maybe they do pretty well in measuring ejection fraction. Somebody like that is important, because in that particular case, do they get an ICD, an internal cardiac defibrillator, or not? And so here's what they did. We asked them to just categorize, and we gave them a leeway. Just 5% batch, and I measured, actually, with biplane Simpson's rule, which is the ASC gold standard, and it was a 30 to 35% ejection fraction. That's the best we could come up with measuring by the only two of the 13 people who made these measurements, these are physicians now, these are echo readers, agreed with me, but well, nine of them came close. 25%, 25 to 30 versus 30 to 35, not that bad, and they would still get their ICD. Two to four of them, they thought these people were desperately ill, and that's a significant difference. But there were two people who thought that they shouldn't get their ICD. They were above 35%, one even up to 45 to 50%. And now, did any of them measure by biplane? No. They had the option, the tools were there, but they didn't. And I think that's the real world. They just, it takes a lot of time and effort to do it. And when left to their own devices, they didn't. Now, seven of them used single plane, five just did an eyeball or estimate, and one did truncated lips. This is real world. Well, here's a normal. Now, yes, all of them, there was by biplane Simpsons, it was 60 to 65%. And most of them did get 60 to 65%, or not all of them. And maybe these two, nine, they're close to each other. But there's still a spread. There's three of them said it was only 55 to 60, and one said it was greater than 70. So there's still a spread, even with a normal ejection fraction. So what do you do about this? Well, one of the problems that I've recognized, I've done the discovery, I see we've got a problem. We need to do better with ejection fraction. And our sonographers had an excuse for using contrast. They always came up with excuses for not doing contrast. It took time. They had to start an intravenous. The nurses had to inject the contrast, all this stuff. But I wanted to prove to them that it was worth the effort. So I had to measure the same measure study with and without contrast. And here's an example of their measurement. They did it, and they didn't even know they're going to have to do it in contrast. They only measured this, and then later I said, okay, you did it, now do it with contrast, and you can see a dramatic difference. And the numbers bear them out. The variability was 19% before, dropped down to around 10%. a significant difference. Now, just to make sure that they got the message, I did it again. This time I did it with a ejection fraction and using both the by using a diastole and systole. And here we have the with and without contrast. And again, the numbers went from 11% to 7%. And then we did one with biplane. Now they had to do it. Here's the four-chamber view without contrast, with contrast. And here's the two-chamber view. And now let me just tell you, contrast not perfect either. Look, the problem they had was these were the bases. They didn't have a good button, but look at the rest of it is very, very much closer than it was without the contrast. And the numbers proved them out. Went from 21% to 10%. Dramatic improvement. And the bottom line is we're doing much more contrast now. No question. It's gone up many, many more times. And most importantly, our accuracy has improved. Now, where to measure? Because we actually store the actual measurements that are done, we can say where. And that's as important as to how and what the number is. Here, for example, is the actual guideline, an illustration from the ASC guideline, from the 2015 guideline. And let's just talk about the green cavity measurement. As you can see, this is at the chordae level. That's where the M mode were. And by the way, I created the M mode measurement, so I have some idea of what they were. And we always said they were going to be at the chordae level. Here's an example, and this dashed line indicates where the M mode would be. And you can see that the angle is different. And now this is a relatively horizontal heart, shall I say. The window is relatively high for this adult. But even then, you can see that this is a different measurement. Now, I knew that the M mode measurements were wrong from the very beginning because I was in the cath lab. I did lateral ventriculograms, and I tried to assess where we were measuring. I didn't have 2D echo at the time, obviously, but I suspected, and so I've always had a suspicion that the angles were not ideal for M mode because it was a single dimension. But anyway, you could see where the measurements are. And one of the things I'd like to point out, that this diameter is at the base. When you go through the chordae, which is where we always made the M mode as well, you actually intersect the septum near its attachment to the aorta. Many people still do it much further out. But that's not where the ASC guidelines have been. But this is where we've always measured them as well. So we actually call it a basal diameter because that's what it is. And that has some clinical value to know that it's basal, because when you have the proximal septum moving differently than the distal septum, that has clinical importance. So here we go, and now have we made any improvement there? And the answer is yes. Look at the spread of the diameters in 2014, and the spread is considerably better and less when in 2015. So yes, by showing them where they're measuring and where we think that should be, things are getting better. Now, let me just say something about the wall thickness. That's where there seems to be some misunderstanding. Although this diagram would suggest that you're supposed to make the septal thickness and the posterior wall thickness all in line and use the so-called cascading effect, with M mode, yes. Well, because it's single dimension. But with 2D, that's not necessary. There's no reason that this septum has to be measured at this location or this location. What you really want is you want the best perpendicular measurement of the wall thickness, both the septal and the posterior wall. Now, in the text, they never tell you exactly how to measure. So this is they don't say that it has to be done in this linear fashion. They just drew the diagram this way for convenience. But this doesn't have to be in the line. In fact, in many cases, it really shouldn't be. For example, if you were to draw a straight line in this particular case, you would end up with a septal thickness of 2 centimeters. Well, that's not really. That's tangential. And you can easily see that this is really only 1.7. All right? And it's even worse in something like this. if you were to do the same one, you come up with a septum that looks like a 1.5 centimeter. But if you go way out here where you see the septum much more, it's perpendicular, you can see both sides of the septum more clearly, it's a 1 centimeter septum. So I think measuring the septum way out here is still within the guidelines, which is, says you want to get the thickness of the septum. And the thickness of the septum is the best example of the, technically, where you can get the septum, and frequently it may be as far out as this one happens to be. And you have, what you don't want is tangential measurements, which are artificially too high. So this is a little confusion. Unfortunately, sometimes the guidelines are not as specific for the instructions, but I can assure you that measuring the septum in whatever location you can that is most technically accurate is the correct way of knowing. Because what you really want to know is what is the average size of that septum. And actually doing it at the base sometimes is misleading because it gets a tangential cut, and this may look thicker than the rest of the septum. The fact is that septum and the posterior wall are usually equal or very close to being equal, and that's why we actually list and measure the septum first and the posterior wall and then the cavity later. We don't do in a cascade. We don't do septum, then cavity, and then posterior wall. Now, we could argue this, and that's part of this test and teach, by the way. It is not intended to be hard and fast and all that. It's an opportunity to, and I do recommend the meetings to see this and discuss it. The creator's not always right. I'm not always right. I try to learn from my mistakes as well. But at least we can see what we're doing, and that's the important thing. If we're not all doing it the same way, let's find out why, and let's get, because you want the best answers you can on a given patient. Here, for example, in this septum, which I showed earlier, any of these measurements could have been accurate. They all should be about the same because it's a very homogeneous, evenly moved septum, and any one of them would give a correct answer. Now, here's another issue. Where do you measure the interventricular septum? Now, that's people could argue this one. They would say, wait a minute, that's not where you want the lateral wall. You want the lateral wall over here. Well, yes, maybe no. How do we know that? Well, some would say, well, this is the compacted left ventricle, and this over here where you're measuring, I'm not even sure I know what you're looking at, but I do faintly see some things there. That's probably all trabeculations. Well, first of all, trabeculations don't usually go down this far to the base, but anyway, we'll accept that as a possible difference of opinion. Well, in the short axis, we don't have that kind of a problem because we're more perpendicular to the structures, and we can see where this lateral wall is in the endocardium. You see that the epicardium, which is a stronger echo, is different than the endocardium. Well, here's another example where you can see this is where you're in. There are some trabeculations at this level. There's some papillary muscles, but you can see where the cavity would be. And this is the comparable four-chamber view, and you can see in this case, you can see the endocardium, and it's not just the trabeculations. It looks like trabeculations, but that's because of the angle, because the vertical structures look like lines, partially because of the angle of the ultrasonic beam to the myocardium. So let me just show you an example of this. And also, I'll give you an example of what the test and teach actually looks like. This is actually the test and teach. What you've been seeing is a PowerPoint with pictures that I've captured. But here the question is, how do you measure this one? Okay, where is the endocardium right here? And this dominant right echo is what many would measure. I would say, no, that's really just the epicardium. Again, you get some idea of all the tools that are available in test and teach. These are tools up at the POP, too. It's a very versatile program. And then, of course, you can this one I can make it play because it's a real versus the PowerPoint, which I couldn't do that. So this is where I would measure this particular one. And then Sicily is even worse. I mean, that's even more difficult. Where do you want to measure that one? Well, and then when we do a biplane, the two chamber views, same kind of a problem. But you can also, you know, when you play it, and one of the gold standards for what's right is you actually look at it. I mean, the eyeball is not something that you just, we give it a bad name, but sometimes it gives you some feel for what's actually going on. And all these measurements should be done by looking at it in real time. Well, turns out that when you do it, you end up with an ejection fraction of about 57%, which the eyeball says is probably about right. That, all right? Well, here's an alternative that I think you should know about. I don't know if any of you use it, but you can actually measure ejection fraction, and this has been done for years. It's kind of gone by the wayside, just like M-mode has gone by the wayside as far as analyzing. But we can do that also with looking at the short axis. Now, as long as you've got a symmetrically ventricle, this is perfectly legitimate and technically frequent better. We don't have much problem in identifying this short axis. Look at that. You can see it in real time. Now, where the endocardium is it's not, you know, you can easily see the difference between endocardium and epicardium. Not a major issue. So we can do that and measure that and then measure it in systole. And then you just combine it with a length. And it's what's called the bullet formula or truncated ellipse, and do it in systole. And lo and behold, you get an ejection fraction 57%. Now, this happens to be exactly the same, but they're frequent. We do both on many, many patients, and they are very comparable. And so it's another option. Well, you might say, well, why bother with that? If you can't see the endocardium, just give them contrast. And that is, of course, a reasonable thing to recommend. So let's look at it from a contrast point of view, just to help identify. And here it is. I mean, here's where we have the endocardium faintly, and there's the epicardium. And you can see that number, and then you compare that with contrast, it turns out that the smaller number, this 4.6, it comes much closer to what the contrast would show. Now, this also shows that contrast is not perfect either. I showed you earlier that they sometimes don't know the basin. Here's one of the reasons. You can see that there's shadowing, and the base frequently doesn't show up as well. But even when you have a better study, here's a better contrast where you see the whole thing. And again, it's this faint endocardial echo, which is really corresponds to where the true endocardium really is. Now, you may say, well, why are you making such a big to-do about finding it? And let's just do contrast in everybody, and you won't have to. Well, here's another the other answer, by the way. If you have a technically good study where you see the endocardium, especially if you have a little effusion, then there's no issue. You can see how the endocardium is much, much fainter than the epicardium, and that these so-called non-compacted muscle is actually a combination of the epicardium and the pericardium in the lung interface. But here's the real problem. This is what we're going to. This is where a lot of the companies are wanting. They want to automatically determine the endocardium and track it. And I'm all in favor. This is done with speckle tracking, and I think more and more automated measurements are not a bad thing. With maybe some little manual corrections at times. And you can see how this is now measuring, tracking the endocardium, just as I indicated earlier. And it will give you an ejection fraction. Now, here's another example. For example, you can see it's technically pretty good. The endocardium is kind of faint. But if you do that and you can measure, you come up with 58% ejection fraction. And when you do it automatically, it comes out about 64%, and they also track this fake endocardium and all as well. However, here's another example where you see the faint endocardium, but if you measure the ejection fraction manually by looking at the faint endocardium, it's 53%. But look where they're tracking. This one missed it for some reason. The algorithm didn't work properly, and then sees the epicardium. It's now 44%. And so that makes a huge difference. So it's not a perfected system. Is that relevant? Yeah, here's an advertisement, a 3D, which is, again, a lot of 3D is coming along. And I agree. I think 3D is the future. But look where they're tracking. You can actually see the endocardium, but their algorithm tracks the epicardium. And interesting enough, this I just put in a couple of days ago. This is the latest issue of JACE. and they're showing, again, all of these automatic measurements, and look what they did. They're tracing the epicardium rather than the endocardium. So it's a current issue, and it's amazing how test and teach, by showing us where all these measurements are done, it gives us an insight that we may not have had otherwise. Now, what about interpretation? We talked about measurements. Here's an example of a coronary patient who's got regional wall, and that's one of the most difficult things that we do in echo is regional wall. And in this particular case, here's a couple of just two images of maybe seven images, whatever this case might have. And here we have they will ask you, we want the ejection fraction, and then we want a full interpretation. Now, we could ask for just multiple choice. I mean, that's what most exams are. Well, multiple choice means that it's a guessing game. The right answer is there. You just have to guess which one it is. But that's not how we interpret echocardiograms. We enter interpretation by opening up a tree or putting in all endless possibilities is what this is. And so this is the tree that we have in test and teach. And now, it does have a nice feature in it that most other diagnostic trees don't have, is that you can search. For example, if you think this is a hypertroph, you can just type in hypertroph and search, and it'll show you all the options for hypertroph. So it's a very convenient way of searching for the correct one, but it's a full report, and you can make it as full as you want. That's somewhat arbitrary. And here's what the answer might be. Here's the user's report. It said there was mild left ventricular debilitation, mildly reduced global left ventricular systolic function. There's an LAD and RCA abnormalities, et cetera. And this is what the creator said, virtually the same thing. And then we give AIDS. After we tell them what the answer is, we can give some proof. We can have that this is a regional wall aid that we can put use in test and teach to prove that this wall was not moving and this wall was moving. In the long axis view, here we see it in the four-chamber view, showing the both the RCA abnormality as well as the LAD abnormality. And then we can do the same sort of thing with stress. And here's what stress with echo, with contrast. And you can see that with peak, that this septal wall is not moving properly. And you can see that in the short axis, not only the anterior wall, but also the inferior wall is not moving properly. And then after we give the interpretation, we can give also the AIDS. We can show how this septum is moving normally at rest, and even with low dose, but with peak dose, it stops moving. And you can see, again, the same thing in the short axis, and you can see how these walls are not moving with peak stress. And then we can also show the angiogram to verify the anatomy of the coronaries, and here's the right coronary anatomy, and you can see it in a still frame as well as the moving picture. And there's the left side showing the lesions in the LAD and the left coronary. Here's another example of a interpretation. This happens to have a dilated aorta. There's hypertrophy, and more importantly, you see this fine filamentous structure moving in and out of the aorta, which of course is a dissection. And here's the evaluation. Now, here we're looking for their outliers, that are those who disagreed with the official interpretation. And three of them didn't mention the hypertrophy. Well, that's not earth shaking. That's not a critical issue. And there was a dilated aorta, both at the levels of the sinuses and as the ascending aorta. Now, when you analyze, if I click on this and I find out exactly who it is and what they said, there are only two that didn't mention either of those. But, okay, but here's the big point. Two out of the 12 failed to mention this section. Now, that's serious. I mean, that makes a big, big difference, and this is what I look for. I look for those interpretations which would have led to mismanagement of the patient, and that, of course, we won't tolerate. And here is the answer in this particular case. Here is a transesophageal that we see after they've made their commitment on the transthoracic, and so I'm showing the dissection. You can see how this flap is almost collapsing in diastole, and then you see the flow going through it, and this, the rest of it is all a false movement. So, in conclusion, echocardiography will remain the backbone of cardiac imaging because of its numerous advantages. No questions asked. However, improved and reliable accuracy and variability of measurements and interpretations have become increasingly important and must be recognized and minimized. Test and Teach is a beautiful tool to try and accomplish this goal because a wrong interpretation is something that's too expensive and we cannot afford. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Feigenbaum. You have the opportunity to ask questions if you use the question box in the lower left-hand side of your screen. We can get those funneled over to Dr. Feigenbaum and start some conversation. So we do have a thought from someone, Dr. Feigenbaum. It says, in the case of sigmoid septum secondary to age, while the rest of septum is perfectly normal, I always tell the resident not to measure it there, but rather anywhere you have clear lines to do this measurement.
I agree. I totally agree. I think that's exactly what you should do. But in the interpretations, I will say there is a sigmoid septum. And I say the left ventricular, the interventricular septum is impinging on the left ventricular outflow tract. And occasionally, I might even measure it as a separate measurement, not as part of the septum. But no, I totally agree that it should be based further away where you have the average septal thickness and it's technically good, and then indicate that the septum is impinging. And that's a common finding.
Okay, great. We have another question that says, how often do you update or add to study questions available to the technologists? And this might be a Curtis question.
Yeah. Well, we do this in Indiana. We do it quarterly. We routinely have the sonographers and our readers go through this exercise every quarter. What they get, the sonographers get two measurement questions, cases to measure, and they may have as many as 28 measurements. Sometimes it may just be a half a dozen. And occasionally I will throw in a multiple choice from a technical. There may be some technical issues. For example, I've thrown where there might be an artifact and they have to recognize the artifact. So there's a variety of tools available to do it. For example, I just did one recently where I showed an obvious breast artifact, breast implant artifact. And so I asked the question, and the reason for the echocardiogram was cardiomyopathy, all right? And so what I asked them was, after they looked at this, I says, what is the likely reason for ordering this examination? And there was a variety of they had an acute infarction, or they had a myocarditis, or they had breast cancer. And I said, yeah, or they had chemo. Well, yes, I said chemotherapy. I didn't say breast cancer. Well, they had to recognize that this was a breast implant artifact. And then the patient had breast cancer, and so it was looking for a myopathy. Now, most of them got it, but some didn't. They just blew their minds and they couldn't figure it out. So some of this is fun and games, but you know, you learn from that. And I don't expect them to get them all right. In fact, with simulation learning, if everybody got everything right, they didn't learn anything. They already knew it. So I try to make this fun. I like to show some cases that are not, that you're not going to see all the time. But hopefully they'll learn, and those that they got wrong, they'll probably learn more from.
Excellent.
Oh, by the way, I didn't finish it all. The readers get two cases and two stress echoes cases. So it's a total of six cases per quarter. Minimum, occasionally I'll throw an extra one in, but that's usually a quickie.
Okay, the next question is, will there be any pediatric modules developed in the future?
Oh, yes. Well, they're already developed. They're not as extensive as the adult, but no, there are some pediatric modules now, and we have every intention of making that a full number of cases. So that's clearly in the works, and some of it already exists.
So now we have some questions about purchasing the product. Can it be purchased for corporate sites like 8 sites, 12 labs, 14 sonographers, and 25 providers? And to that, I would say we'd be happy to talk to you offline, Debbie. I've got your information, and we'll contact you to see what will work for you. We have another question that says, please share the difference between the standard and professional versions.
The professional version is you can create your own cases, and that's fun. I would if you have the time and inclination to create your own cases, I would recommend it. But it's a little time consuming. There's a slight learning curve, but it's getting easier. There, the technology is changing thanks to Curtis. Creating a case is becoming less and less difficult. But that's the major difference. Or you can just even modify. If if I did this case, and I'm not doing all the cases, but I do most of the cases. But if you would like to see that the interpretation modified, you do things slightly different at your institution, you could do that with the professional version. So it gives a fair amount of versatility. Depending upon your personnel and whether you have somebody who wants to get involved, they do. It's great fun.
We have a question. Is the tool compatible with all Echo software?
Well, you'd have to ask them. I haven't run into any problems so far. I know we use multiple different instruments, machines, and I know there's been a variety of others, so I can't imagine yet. The person, by the way, my son, Tom, who developed this, he did ProSolve. I don't know how many of you remember ProSolve. It's now Fuji Synapse. He developed that. And so he knows all about recording echocardiograms. And so he would know that very, very well. I doubt if there's anything that's not compatible.
All right, we have somebody that wants to know, how do you get Test and Teach? Is it an organizational or personal product?
I'm not going to be involved with that. I think one of you could either answer that better than I am.
Well, actually, we have multiple versions available. We do have the institutional version. We have an educational version that is focused on sonographer learning centers, and then we also have an individual product for people who just want to test their own skills. So we have all different levels. If you go to our website, which is asecho.org/echo-test-and-teach, you'll see all the different versions, and we also have pricing there as well. Let's see. Would a residency program be considered an educational program for pricing purposes? No, we actually have kind of geared that more toward the sonography learning area. We do have a number of residency programs that are, in fact, using it, though, as a training tool, and they find it very helpful.
Yeah, our residents use it.
They want to know if Test and Teach is online or a DVD-type product. It's actually a web-based product, so you can access it from anywhere. You can access from home, your lab, anywhere that you have access to the internet, basically.